Cusco's cool. So let me welcome everybody again now for this second day of the Cusco's cool, which originally should have taken place in Zurich, and I think it would have been a nice weather. And I'm really a little bit sorry that we cannot do the hiking that we have planned, but still, I hope you enjoy the meeting. Let me also thank, because that has been not mentioned yesterday, also thank the local organizing team, Daniel Ecker, Max Werninghaus, and Federico Roy, who were in charge of planning. And now it's Mattia to go with the virtual planning. So my name is Stefan Philipp. I'm happy to chair this first session and also in the, this school in the morning. And let me welcome Patrice Berthet, who is working at the Cyrille-Sacquet in the Quantronics Group. And he will talk today about quantum sensing of spins. And for this, he uses superconducting circuits. And so I'm happy to have you here, and I'm looking forward to the talk. So the stage is yours, Patrice. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Stefan, and hello to everyone. So indeed, I will talk about the quantum sensing of spins with superconducting circuits. I'm Patrice Berthet. I work in the Quantronics Group in CEA-Saclay near Paris. And so, let me start with the motivation of our talk. Of this talk, and the motivation is the field of nanoscale magnetic resonance. And as we all know, this is a picture of a commercial electron paramagnetic resonance spectrometer. And as we know, this is fantastically useful, but it has a relatively low sensitivity, which means that you need macroscopic samples to detect the signal that you are interested in. And so this has motivated a very large effort worldwide and since many years to push the sensitivity of magnetic resonance to the nanoscale. And one very well-known method, obviously, especially here, is optical detection of magnetic resonance. And many of you know that this enables single-spin sensitivity, as is the case, for instance, for NV centers. But other schemes involve scanning probes, and this also involves enables single-spin detection, even by scanning NV centers above electron spins trapped in a surface, and also electrical detection. But what we are interested in is an alternative route towards nanoscale magnetic resonance, which has its own specificity and its own interest. And the idea is to use superconducting circuits for electron spin resonance detection. And so I will explain in the first part of the talk the motivation and the principles of quantum limited EPR spectroscopy. Sorry, I apologize. Sometimes I will say EPR spectroscopy for electron paramagnetic resonance spectroscopy, and equivalently ESR spectroscopy for electron spin resonance spectroscopy. This is really the same thing, right? And then I will give describe two experiments that we have done recently. One showing that squeezing, micro squeezing can enhance the sensitivity of ESR spectroscopy, because this is a school about quantum sensing. So using quantum squeezing really fits well into this focus. And I will also discuss a novel electron spin hyperpolarization scheme that also relies on this quantum sensing and this coupling of spins to quantum superconducting circuits. All right, so let me explain a bit what I have in mind when I speak of EPR spectroscopy, or more generally magnetic resonance spectroscopy. And here I will focus on the method of detection, which is called the inductive detection. So what does it mean? You have a sample that contains the spins to detect, right? And here we are speaking of paramagnetic impurities that are really very dilute in the crystal. So they are just sitting in the crystal, but they do not really interact between each other. And so to detect these very small magnetic moments that are present in the sample, the sample is inserted in a microwave cavity, which has its own resonance frequency that I will call omega naught, and is placed in a magnetic field B naught. and be not changes by the Zeeman effect the frequency, the Larmor frequency of the electron spins inside the sample. And you know, if you have free electron spins like in the vacuum, this Larmor frequency would start at zero in zero field and would increase linearly with a slope that is 28 gigahertz per Tesla. Right? This is the gyromagnetic ratio of electron spins in free space. And this means that at a certain field, the Larmor frequency of the spins will match the frequency of the microwave resonator. And so if we probe this resonator with a microwave field at frequency omega naught, and we sweep the magnetic field B naught, at a certain point, there will be an absorption signal from the spins, because the spins interact with the microwave field inside the resonator. And this magnetic field, this oscillating microwave field, is described. So in magnetic resonance, very commonly it is called a B1 field, right? So B0 is the static field, and B1 is the microwave oscillating field. And here is the first maybe specificity of our experiment, is that we will treat the microwave field B1 as a quantum operator. And we will see why this is the case, right? So this quantum operator then is described using creation and annihilation operators for a photon in the mode of the microwave cavity, A and A dagger. And then there is just a proportionality constant which describes the RMS vacuum fluctuations of this microwave magnetic field. And this I call delta B1. Right? Now, this coupling between the spins and the microwave field is described by the dipolar magnetic Hamiltonian, and this is the Hamiltonian. So you see it's the sum over all the spins of their magnetic dipole MJ scalar B1, and this can be rewritten in this simple form where here I have introduced, so here again you can recognize the creation and annihilation operators of the microwave field, of a photon in the microwave field, and these are the raising and lowering operators of one spin, of spin J, right? So this operator takes spin J from down to up and down and up to down, this one, right? So, and the proportionality constant here is called the coupling constant, and this is an important parameter in our experiment, and this is basically the strength of the coupling between a single spin and one single microwave photon in the resonator. All right, and what is the value of this coupling constant? Well, it's proportional to the magnetic, the gyromagnetic ratio of the electron, gamma. Then there is a matrix element between spin down and spin up of the operator Sx. Very commonly, this value is going to be close to a half. It's maybe not exactly one half, but this is the order of magnitude that depends on the system that we are interested in. And then there is the quantum fluctuation of the magnetic field, the delta B1, at the position of spin J. Right? So this is, and this Hamiltonian, you see, it's a sum over many spins, but for one spin, you see that the shape of this Hamiltonian is the shape, is called the James Cummings Hamiltonian, and this describes the interaction of one two-level system with one field in the resonator. All right, so what are we doing, going to do? So what I said is that, okay, when the field is going to meet the, when the Larmor frequency of the spin is going to meet the resonance frequency of the resonator, we're going to see some absorption. Now, in reality, the absorption is very weak, so there is a better way to measure the spins. And this way, this is the way that we will use throughout this whole talk, and this is called the Hahn-Echo sequence. Let me explain you, and this is the thing that we will really, that we measure in our experiment. So how does it work? Imagine that we have applied the right magnetic field B naught, and that all the spins Larmor frequency is now close to resonance with the resonator frequency. And now instead of measuring the continuous absorption, we're going to apply some pulses to the resonator, and these pulses are going to drive the spins. So We can do a first pi over 2 pulse. So this is the Bloch sphere. You see, it takes the spin down to the equatorial plane of the sphere with this first pi over 2. And then we're going to wait. Now, during the waiting time, as you probably know, there is a dispersion of Larmor frequency, and that not every spin in the crystal has a slightly different frequency of its colleagues or friends, and that's because of the local environment, either magnetic or due to strain or due to electric field. There are always things in a crystal that make the local environment of one spin slightly different from the others, and this gives rise to the inhomogeneous broadening. And this is causing the magnetic dipoles to spread over the Bloch sphere in a quite rapid time in general. But as probably you know, this spreading can be counteracted by a refocusing pulse, a pi pulse. And so this pi pulse will kind of invert the time for the spin and will lead to refocusing of the spins of all the magnetic dipoles at time 2 tau. And at time 2 tau, all the dipoles will come back in phase, and there will be like this gigantic, the sum of all the dipoles will form some oscillating kind of antenna, magnetic antenna inside the cavity, and this leads to the emission of a small microwave signal that is the echo, that is the spin echo. So you see, for those who are familiar with ND centers, this is a little bit different way of detecting a spin, because when you detect the spin echo from one NV center, you have only one spin. So you have to apply a third pi over 2 pulse, and then you detect the fluorescence, meaning you detect the sigma z, you detect the population of the single NV center in spin up or spin down. Here we are dealing with ensembles of electron spins, so the Hahn echo sequence only consists in pi over 2, tau, pi, tau, and then the echo is emitted because it's emitted by the sigma x, the oscillating sigma x component of the spins. Right? This is the slight difference. You can ask me if you have questions about this. All right, so now this is this microwave pulse is emitted, and to detect it, basically we amplify it because it's a small signal, and then we mix it with some local oscillator. Sorry, it's not represented here, but there should be some like line coming with, there is a local oscillator that will generate a bit tone between the local oscillator and the spin echo, and this will give rise to the maybe one of the two quadratures of the field showing some signal. You see that I will use the quadratures of the field I and Q. Yeah. Okay, and now the question is, what is the amplitude of this signal? And really, what we are interested in magnetic resonance, is to have the largest signal and the lowest noise, best signal to noise, right? And it's possible to demonstrate that the signal, the amplitude of the spin echo is proportional to the total number of spins. That's not very surprising. And then to the polarization of spins, this is a quantity that depends on temperature, right? So you know that at the lowest temperature, if the temperature is much smaller than the than h bar omega s, than the Larmor frequency of the spins, then all the spins are in the ground state, all spins are polarized. But this is a rare situation in magnetic resonance. More often we are facing situations in which the temperature is larger, and then only a small fraction of the spins are polarized, and this reduces the echo signal amplitude. So this is for these two terms. But the spin echo signal amplitude is also proportional to the coupling strength, G. Here I'm considering that all the spins have the same G, just for simplicity. Then this is just proportional to G. And then it's proportional to the resonator parameter, square root of Q divided by omega. And Q divided by omega is basically is the damping time of a photon. So the higher the quality factor you see of the resonator, the higher the signal. All right, so why are superconducting circuits interesting in that context? Well, you know, the first thing is that circuit QED experiments, as you probably know, they are done first of all at low temperature, very low temperature, millikelvin temperature in general. So that's just good for polarization, right? If you imagine that we work at 7 gigahertz, if you work at 300K, you have a very small polarization of 0.1% of the spins, but if you cool down to 10 millikelvin, then all spins are polarized. So that's kind of trivial. Of course, we gain in signal by polarizing the spins. It's not the only thing. First, so we also gain because when we go to lower temperature, we reduce the magnetic noise, so this means less noise, and also the field, the microfield itself, has no longer thermal noise, only remain quantum fluctuations, and this I will discuss in detail later. Then we have these superconducting microresonators. You see that in general, in standard ESR or EPR spectroscopy, the spins, the cavity that are used for measuring the spin, they are volumetric cavities, right? They are of the order of the magnitude of the wavelengths of the microwave, and this wavelength is several centimeters. So this means that the mode volume is quite large, so the microwave field is kind of diluted over many centimeter cube, right? But you remember that in the spin-photon coupling G, there is the quantum fluctuations of the magnetic field, and quite intuitively, it's clear that the more confined the mode, the better for G, for delta B1, the higher delta B1. So the idea is that by using micro resonators, you see that here this is the size of the resonators can be a millimeter, but in fact the size of the antenna, the inductance is even microns, as we will discuss later. And so the field will be confined within microns around this wire. And this is, of course, very favorable for the delta B1 and therefore for G. And finally, its superconducting circuits also enable new types of microwave amplifiers that are nearly noiseless. And I will explain that in the following. This is then, we are also quantum limited for amplification. And all that is good. This is good for the noise. So this is good for the signal, and this is good for the noise. So a bit more details on the superconducting microresonators that we are going to consider. You see that this is again a close-up. Often we are going to use samples in which the spins are implanted just below the surface, like maybe typically 100 nanometers. So our really the example that we are going to see throughout this talk is the case of donors in silicon. Because silicon is a good substrate for fabricating superconducting circuits, but it's also a very good substrate for spins. And so silicon hosts very good electron spins. And so this is a bit a prototypical system for us. And so you see that here, this is a close-up of the inductance, which is the active area of the device. You see this is the wire. So it generates a B1 field, which is shown by these purple lines. And you see that it's really localized around microns or even 100 nanometers around the inductor, so the field is very confined. Even then, we have typically facing coupling constants of order a few tens of hertz, like maybe 50, 100, or maybe a kilohertz, and that's still smaller than the resonator damping rate, so we are in the so-called bad cavity regime of circuit QED. Right? We are not in the strong coupling regime as with superconducting circuits. We are in a regime where the coupling is smaller than the damping rate, and this means that we have other effects than the strong coupling. But we still have, this is still, in a sense, the strongest spin photon coupling that have been achieved in the microwave regime. So it's much, much stronger than if we had a volumetric cavity. If we have a volume cavity, G would be a millihertz, right? So we are in a regime that is close to strong coupling, but not yet quite strong coupling. All right, so, and this is like a photograph of like the sample. The sample is this little silicon piece, and by convenience, we like to put it in some copper box, and then we interrogate it by probing it with microwave antenna. And this is an example of a microwave resonance. You see, this is measured at 10 millikelvin at 7 gigahertz, and this has a quality factor of 300,000, typically. Now, this is all very good, but for EPR spectroscopy, there are some constraints, and these constraints are for magnetic field applied, because as you probably know, the magnetic field and superconductivity don't go very well together. And so we have to apply, first of all, be not parallel to the sample, because otherwise the Meissner effect will destroy the superconducting resonator for very low fields. Even then, with depending on the material, we cannot apply too high fields. For aluminum resonators, it's not desirable to the field should be like quite a bit lower than 100 millitesla. If we use niobium or niobium nitride or NBTIN, we can go up to 1 tesla, which is still good for doing a lot of things in magnetic resonance. All right, so I wanted to come back also to this issue of fluctuations of the microwave field, because I think it's maybe not trivial for all of you. I wanted to show you, so what I plot here is a quantity. You see, this is the mean value of delta I squared for a field at thermal equilibrium. What is delta I squared? Imagine that you are plotting the state of a microwave field in a 2D plane, right? So this 2D plane represents the amplitude and phase of a microwave field. For instance, if I take a monochromatic microwave field, I can describe it by a certain field amplitude that will be at a certain distance from the center and a certain phase phi, right? But I can also describe it by its two quadratures, which is the real part of, you know, the field and the imaginary part of the field. Here I represent the field at a certain time. Of course, you know, in real life, it will, this field state will rotate in the complex plane at the frequency of the field oscillation. But I consider that I put myself in the rotating frame. So then the field does not move at all. It's static. And so one field corresponds to one value in this phase space, right? Now, the field, monochromatic field would be 1 point, right? A classical monochromatic field would be 1 point, but the field has noise, it has fluctuations, and therefore there are in fact a probability distribution to find a certain amplitude or a certain phase or a certain value of I and a certain value of Q. And this is described by some kind of, you know, disk of uncertainty. And this disk is characterized by the variance or a standard deviation here. This is the square root of the variance. And as you know, this the higher the, so at thermal equilibrium, at high temperatures, this variance would be directly related to the temperature. And this is given by this formula. Here I use the I describe it in reduced units. So by convenience, I divide KT by h bar omega to have a dimensionless number, okay? So really it's a number. This is just a number. You see it's 1, 2, 3, etc. So, okay, so at high temperature, this this variance is proportional to the temperature KT. Now, if you reduce the temperature, this describes, this goes down linearly, but below h bar omega naught, this stops working. And the variance of the field stops going down, and it reaches a certain value, which is 0.25 when temperature goes down to zero. What does this mean? It means that the microwave field has reached its quantum ground state. The field in its, is in its quantum, is in state of lowest energy. There are no more thermal fluctuations. However, there are field fluctuations. So the delta I squared is not zero. It's in fact, this standard deviation is a half and the variance is a quarter. This is called the quantum limit. So in the quantum limit, the field in it is in its ground state. Energy is like at the lowest value possible. It's in the ground state is an energy eigenstate. However, it's not an eigenstate for the field, and therefore there are field fluctuations. All right? Now in our experiments, this is where we are. So we are at 7 gigahertz and 20 milli-K. So you see we are deep in the quantum limit. The field is deep in its ground state. And therefore, the dominant source of fluctuation is of quantum origin. So that's for the field. If I just take some LC resonator, the field at thermal equilibrium is in its ground state. We are in the quantum limit. But this is not the whole story for quantum fluctuations, because in general, we want to amplify some field, right? So we want to look at it from the outside of the fridge, so not at 20 milli-K. So we need to connect this very low temperature, very low noise field to some room temperature detection. And for that, we need to amplify the field. So now we have to be also concerned, because what we want is the noise at the output that we measure in the lab to be quantum limited. And this is not so simple, because we have to amplify this field. And so what is nice is that superconducting circuits enable to amplify the quantum fluctuations of the field without adding extra noise or very little. And let me explain that. This is thanks to superconducting amplifiers that are called Josephson parametric amplifiers, or JPAs. And here is a schematic of our amplifier. There are many amplifier designs. This is just a very small bibliography. There are like, it's a field in itself to build the best amplifiers. But ours works in this way. We have some LC circuits, some superconducting LC circuits with squids. And squids are like flux-tunable inductors, so the frequency of this resonator will depend on the flux through each loop. So then we can pump, we can put some microwave field inside the loop and pump this resonator at twice its frequency. If we do that, then there will be parametric gain for the signal entering and going out. And this is the example of one such gain curve. You see that we can have up to 25 dB of gain. And if we use it in this way, where the pump is not quite equal to twice the input frequency, interestingly, the quantum fluctuations will have a little bit more noise. This is enforced by quantum mechanics. The amplifier has to double the noise from the quantum fluctuation. This is due to Cave's theorem. Now, in the there is a degenerate mode of operation where the frequency of the pump tone is exactly equal to twice the signal frequency. And then, in this context, the signal, the gain, the parametric gain becomes phase sensitive. So you see that, and this is a plot showing this, you see that the gain can go from 25 dB to minus 25 dB. So you are, in fact, amplifying the, de-amplifying the signal for a certain phase. And in this regime, if we amplify for the quadrature that is amplified, there is no added noise. So this is a strictly silent amplifier. All right, this is just a photograph of a typical fridge and another one to show that these are like big experiments, but all this is cool to 10 millikelvin, right? I don't have much time to explain, but there are attenuators to thermalize the field. There are circulators, and this is like the coils, and the sample goes in, and we have the amplifier in a separate box, right? And now spin systems that we can study with this. Basically, we can study every spin system, any spin system, but we like, in this talk, we're going to focus on donors in silicon, as I explained. So bismuth donors in silicon, so a few words to explain what they are. They are substitutional bismuth atoms in the silicon lattice. So they will take the place of a silicon atom. They make four covalent bonds with the silicon lattice, but there is this extra fifth electron because bismuth belongs to the fifth column of the periodic table. And this fifth electron at room temperature is given to the conduction band of the silicon, but at low temperature, it becomes trapped on the donor because the donor is now an ion and it has a weak potential of a few tens of few tens of milli electron volt. And at you know, temperatures below a few Kelvin, this temperature is much smaller than this energy scale, so the electron becomes trapped around each bismuth atom. So this is this unpaired electron that lives in the silicon, but is like trapped around this singly charged ion, and this gives rise to a paramagnetic signal. This is a prototypical signal system for EPR spectroscopy with a very simple spin Hamiltonian that has a hyperfine term and the Zeeman effect for both the electron spin and the nuclear spin. And so bismuth has a large hyperfine coupling and a large nuclear spin 9.5. So there are 20 states, and it's a bit complex energy state, but at moderate fields, basically at low fields, these states are grouped in two manifolds of like respectively 9 and 11 states separated by 7.37 gigahertz. And when we apply a field, this degeneracy is lifted by the Zeeman effect. And then we have transitions between all these states. And now here I have shown the transitions that are allowed at low magnetic field between these levels. And you see there are like a number of transitions. And when we probe So there is an implantation profile, this is what I showed. And when we probe the echo signal, we see peaks exactly at the magnetic fields where we should find the bismuth donor signal. So this shows that we are measuring these spins. Don't pay attention to the shape of these peaks, or rather pay attention, and we know where this comes from, but I don't have time to explain. So you can ask me later if you want. All right, so this is our system. We have our cavity. We can send drive pulses. We have the paramp, and then we have we keep amplifying and measuring the spin signal. And this is a typical spin signal. We see that we apply a first pulse, then a second one, and then we detect the echo. And we are going to plot the integral of this echo. This is our signal, right? And nice thing for EPR is that the pulse power is very low because the fields are strongly coupled to the spins are very strongly coupled to the field. So we don't need lots of power to drive them. And then the sensitivity is remarkable. It's between 100 and 2000 spins per echo. And this is like 5 or 6 orders of magnitude gain compared to the state of the art. This is due to, as I explained, the strong coupling, the low temperatures, and the parametric amplifier. And in fact, it enables new spin characterization at millikelvin temperatures. I don't really have time to go into much detail, but just to show you, this is an example, again, on bismuth donors in silicon, that, for instance, we can measure new coherence properties of the donor. This is a measurement of the bismuth donor in a specific at a specific transition, which is called a clock transition, because you see that here, this level, this is this green level, it actually is stable in magnetic field. There is a place in which magnetic field sensitivity of this level goes to zero. It's flat. This is called the clock transition. And here, then the spins are not sensitive to magnetic field fluctuation. So you expect long coherence times. And in fact, when we measure, we do measure long coherence time up to 300 milliseconds. This is just coherence time by obtained by varying tau in a spin echo sequence, right? This is the echo amplitude as a function of 2 tau. Just to show you, this coherence time is very strongly temperature dependent. So this motivates, it changes even at 200 millik, we lose nearly an order of magnitude. So it motivates that it's interesting to measure spins at millikelvin temperatures in some context. Right. Okay, now just to show you, here I've spoken about our usual setup, but it would be nice to go beyond the quantum limit. And this is what I want to discuss briefly. Imagine here, as I explained, we are still the noise that is at the output, you see, of this signal. It comes from quantum fluctuations. So you could say, okay, now this is more or less the best we can do, right? But it is not the best we can do, as you probably know from quantum sensing, and can we go beyond? So we have, I will present one strategy to go beyond, and this is to use special quantum states that have less fluctuations than the vacuum. This is in this talk, but I really want to emphasize that we have found another way to do that, and that is to use a detector that is sensitive to the energy of the photons and not to the field. Because the vacuum is an energy eigenstate, so the vacuum, when we detect only energy, the vacuum is perfectly noiseless. And this will be described by Emanuele Albertinales later today. All right, so how now let me focus with just the same setup, but how do we do to go beyond the quantum fluctuation? Well, we can use, you see that here in this plot that I have shown at the lowest temperature, sorry, the field has this little disk of uncertainty, and this is the vacuum state. But there are other states than the vacuum that have maybe more energy, but less fluctuations. And the famous squeezed states are exactly like that. You see that here, if we want to go down, we can go down in this quadrature. We can have states that have fluctuations that are ellipsoidally shaped, with low fluctuations on the I quadrature and more fluctuations on the Q quadratures. This is obligatory because of Heisenberg relation. The product of the two should be larger than 1 over 16. You know, this still means that we can reduce one at the expense of the other. And this is the field of quantum squeezing. And how to generate the quantum squeezing? Well, it turns out this is actually very simple because we just have to operate, again, this same amplifier as I already showed, but as the input of the setup. And because in the degenerate mode, as I explained, in some phase you amplify the signal, and in other phase you deamplify it. So now imagine that this amplifier is working on the vacuum. Then the vacuum, one quadrature is going to be amplified, the other one deamplified. And this is exactly what we want. So what we do is we take a second amplifier, we put it at the output of the setup, and then we pump it, and we generate this squeezed state. And then we still do the same spin echo experiment, but this time the spin echo is going to be emitted in a squeezed vacuum. And so we should have less fluctuations in the echo carrying quadrature and more fluctuations on the other. And so this is, without entering into details, you see this is the characterization of the squeezing. This is an experiment that we've done in 2017. And you see that this is the red curve compared to the blue curve. You see that for a certain phase, we do have less noise. These are noise measurements. And then we can also produce the echo. And we see that the echo amplitude, this is here we compare the average echo signal with squeezing on and squeezing off. You see it's exactly the same. This is good because we wanted to have the same signal. We just wanted to reduce the noise. But the statistics is indeed the noise is indeed reduced, nevertheless. So we have improved the signal to noise, and this is described in this paper. Note that to achieve this, we had to pulse the squeezing on only during the echo emission, and this is like an important detail that I will maybe not have time to explain. The signal to noise enhancement is modest, but this is a proof of concept. All right. So I now want to emphasize a very important point of our experiment. This is the Purcell effect. Because in fact, this is the explanation of why we needed to pump, to pulse the squeezing during this experiment. And that's due to back action of the squeeze radiation on the spins via the Purcell effect. And let me focus on the Purcell effect now. The Purcell effect is a novel spin relaxation channel. So in general, how do spin reach thermal equilibrium? Imagine a spin is in its excited state, it has to go back to the ground state for thermal equilibrium. If we are at a temperature that the all spins are polarized, then the spin will exchange energy to its experiment, emit energy towards its environment. And in general, in magnetic resonance, a spin would relax by emitting a phonon or by flipping another spin in the environment nearby. It can also relax by emitting a microwave photon. Remember that this is 7 GHz transition, but if we compute the probability that this happens in free space, well, it will happen once every 10,000 years. So this is really negligible. So basically, spontaneous emission of microwave photons in the vacuum is negligible for spins. Now, this is not true when spins are put in a cavity, because the cavity alters the mode density, and so at the resonance, the spins seem a much stronger fluctuations of the electromagnetic field thanks to the cavity mode. And Ed Purcell in 1946 said that a spin would have an enhanced damping rate by this formula. You see that here, this is proportional to the quality factor, to the coupling constant squared. And here you have suppression of the Purcell rate when the spins are detuned from the resonator. And this Purcell effect has been observed for, you know, then this Purcell relaxation can become the dominant relaxation channel for cavities with a small volume, mode volume and a high Q. For systems with electrical dipoles, it has been reached in the 1980s, but for spins, it has only been reached recently in our experiments. And this is actually good because it allows to shorten T1 on demand and to accelerate spin thermalization. And I want to show you that in our experiments, we actually do reach this regime, and the proof is that. So here is the measurement of T1 in our experiment. How do we proceed? This is what we perform is an inversion recovery sequence. First, we excite the spins by pi pulse. Then we wait some time, and we measure a spin echo signal. You see that after the pi pulse, the spin echo is inverted. So at short time, we measure a negative signal for the spin echo. But when we go on, the spins progressively relax towards the ground state, so we reach thermal equilibrium. And this exponential damping gives T1. Now, what we have done is to measure C1 as a function of the detuning between the spins and the resonator. This is omega s minus omega naught. And you see that at resonance we find 1 second, or close to 1 second, but as soon as we detune the two systems, the T1 goes to 1,000 seconds. And this is the Purcell formula. The red curve is the Purcell formula that I showed in the previous slide, without adjustable parameter other than some non-radiative rate that suppresses the Purcell, takes over the Purcell relaxation at large detunings. So this means that it's good, because it means that resonance, we are really dominated by the Purcell effect in this ESR measurement. And in fact, this is what enables the measurements at 10 millik. Now, I want to address, to just raise the question that Emmanuel Albertinale is going to answer in his talk later today. Wouldn't it be nice to observe the emission from the spins? You see that here, during all this time, what we are saying is that the spins emit photons in their environment and they relax to the ground state. So here what we see is the effect on the spins of this relaxation. We are directly measuring the spin with the spin echo sequence. But here, during this time, there is also microwave photons that are emitted, except these photons are incoherent. So we cannot detect them with the usual local oscillator setting because it's incoherent radiation. And Emanuele is going to show you that it is actually possible to detect these spontaneous emitted photons, the Purcell photons emitted during spin relaxation. All right, so I will skip all the rest of my talk and go to the conclusion. I'm sorry for that, it was a bit long. Go to the conclusion, just saying that I have shown you that superconducting circuits enable quantum limited sensitivity for the inductive detection of EPR spectroscopy. We have demonstrated a spin sensitivity of 10 spin per root hertz entering the few spin regime. The sensitivity can be enhanced further beyond the quantum limits using quantum squeezing, and new types of detectors such as a photon counter, and Emmanuel is going to talk about this, and that this is enabled also by the radiative spin relaxation due to the Purcell effect. And here I just want to to thank my colleagues, and in particular Emanuele Albertinale, he's not in red, Audrey Bienfait, who is a former member, Bartolo Albanese, and Vishal Ranjan, who took some of the data that I showed. And thank you for your attention.
So thanks, Patrice, for this very interesting talk. And sorry for pressing you to finish in time. I would have loved to hear more about spin ESR experiments and how to increase sensitivity. So we have time for one question. Do I see the questions, Mattia, or do you see questions?
In the chat, no one. Okay, I see Federico.
Yeah, Federico.
No. Sorry, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so sorry, Patrice, I didn't quite catch when you were showing these this resonance with the Purcell filter, the Purcell effect. What is the parameter that you're changing to change? The T1, effectively.
Sorry, so here you are speaking of this curve, am I right?
Yes, exactly.
Yes, so here what we do is we measure the T1 for spins that are resonant with the... Sorry, I didn't have time to explain properly, I apologize. So here at delta equals zero, we measure the T1 as I explained. Now for the other points, what we do is in between, after the pi pulse, we detune the spins. So we apply a small current pulse in our coil. So this detunes the spins from resonance, okay? So during the evolution time, the spins are detuned. Now, if you see, and because they relax by the Purcell effect, you see that in this formula, there is the detuning here. So when the detuning is much larger than the frequency line width of the resonator, the Purcell effect is going to be strongly suppressed by this term, right? So what we are probing is the dependence of the Purcell rate on this term in this curve, right? This curve is this term, okay? Is it clear? This is the detuning, all right? So So you see, what we are showing is that T1 follows the formula of Purcell.
And sorry, and the tuning is applied by a magnetic field, or is it
by a magnetic field. We change the coil. We have, you know, the coil so that we have a, you know, to place the field in resonance, we have a coil. We apply some certain field. And what we do is just after the pipe pulse, we change the current in the coil, right? And then we put the field, the spins back in resonance for the echo detection. Right, so we have this a small magnetic field pulse, if you want, during the waiting time T. Okay?
Okay, thanks so much.
So, okay, so thanks, Patrice, again. Unfortunately, we don't have time for questions now, but there will be the coffee breakout sessions then later on, and I hope, Patrice, you can stick on to the meeting.
Yes, so, when are the coffee breaks? Sorry.
That's in...